They talked about being a good soldier before and having a military wartime mindset and effort. And you may say to yourself, well, that sounds like a great ideal, but is that really what God wants? I would say to you that there is historical precedence. We should just go back all the way to the early church. What did the early church look like? How did the early church operate? What did it do? I think now we try and do church according to our Western American mind now. And there's nothing necessarily wrong with this picture and what I'm about to say, but hear me out until I get through this. If we have two services on Sunday, we have a Wednesday night service, we've got a Christmas program, a song service, an intellectual discipleship curriculum, then we made it. Everything's okay. Everything's fine. In other words, we have this kind of cookie cutter subculture of the whole church. If we look like this, if we do this and we don't do that, and we have our T's crossed and our I's dotted, then we are good. But where our greatest revelation, however, is Holy Ghost illuminated scripture. If those things accomplish the purpose of trying to then do what God is doing and they are a vehicle, that's very good. But if the vehicle becomes the end, then we've lost the whole power and glory of God that he wants to dump out through his people. So what was the early church actually like? What was the thrust of the early church? Did they go for numbers? Did they just try and put everything down? Bless God, I had this many on Sunday morning. No. I do say they counted the numbers. There were 3,000 that were saved, but that was not their thrust. Was their thrust programs? Did they have to make some kind of flashy thing in order to attract the world to come in and hear the gospel? No, they preached the gospel. Was their thrust entertainment? No, it was not entertainment. Was their thrust social? No, their thrust wasn't social. However, we do see that they gathered together each and every day, breaking bread, having fellowship, and praying, and we need to do that all the more even in these days. I think it's safe to say we could sum up the thrust of the early church in two words: holiness and evangelism. Holiness in that we need a clean people preaching, teaching, and living a clean gospel to a clean and wicked world, starting with the heart of wicked men. I say holiness and evangelism because we can see that if you look throughout the entire New Testament, you can see, first of all, that Jesus preached about, it's not just what we do on the outside, the wickedness flows from the heart. So he preaches about having a holy heart and in turn, a holy life, because if the fountain is clean, then our actions will be clean. When we look at Paul's writings, we see that not only does he doctrinally expound the need to be justified, to be regenerated, to be sanctified holy, to be filled with the Holy Ghost, he then gets to the end of most of those epistles that he's written and says, here's how the rubber meets the road. Here's how you live. And by the way, there's a world around you outside that doesn't have what you have, doesn't know what you know, and you need to go and share that with them. So I believe it's safe to say that the thrust of the early church was holiness and evangelism. The early church waited for divine power from above and continued to seek for repeated effusions of the Holy Ghost. Why? Because the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds. The early church also was a pioneering church planting movement. They had one mission: spread the gospel to the uttermost parts of the world. And I think we've changed the church into a program machinery or some kind of form or tradition instead. There's nothing intrinsically wrong with having some kind of a program or having some sort of method of how to do things. But if that is the end, we have killed the true vitality of the church and the true spirit of the church. The church is about its mission. The danger is when the vehicles become the mission themselves. So the way we do church at large has created and maintained professional pew sitters while paying those elite ecclesiastical people and the elite ecclesiastical machinery to do the work that sometimes I think we're too scared or lazy to do ourselves. We say we have the same Holy Ghost baptism that they did. I don't know about you, but when I open up the book of Acts and I read the book of Acts, I don't see a lifeless, dead, limp church. I see a church that is filled with supernatural power, a church that knows their God and that is empowered by their God. When I think that some people, when we say we have the Holy Ghost, I'm just like, Lord, there's got to be something more than what is going on right at the moment. If I have the same spirit that those men had, then I should be seeing the same power that those men have. And God help us each and every one. That's what the early church was about. And the early church wasn't a complicated working of how all this fits together. It was so simple. The early church wasn't about buildings. They were about the mission. When new converts were born, they didn't just pan them off to the discipleship experts. All Christians are called the disciple. We are to teach others to obey the command of Christ. And just, I would ask you this question. Have you met Jesus? Did he save you? Did he change your life? After you've been saved and you're walking with him, has he taught you anything? Has he told you, my child, I don't want you to do this, or I want you to do that? If he has, can't you share that with someone else? Can't you tell somebody what it was like to be living in sin, to be walking through the course of this world and in the course of this world, and then the time that you met Jesus face to face and how he saved you, how he transformed you, and how he showed you that those things that you once did are not what you're to be doing now, and the changes you have to make in the way that you think and in what you do and where you go. Can't you tell that to somebody else? That's not up to just the pastor. That's up to you, the living and walking and breathing epistles of Christ. There is thorough doctrinal teachings that we should leave to those that the Holy Ghost has gifted to do so. We're not talking about you expounding the scriptures at large. We're talking about you being a witness. And there are those that God has gifted because when Jesus rose up on high, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. So there are people that are gifted to teach, and there are certain things that may be above and beyond our capacity, and we can find those people who God has gifted, and we can ask them, and they can do the job of teaching that you and I can't do, but you and I can be witnesses. All can teach practical godliness and obedience peppered with doctrine. Doctrine is only good in so much as it has a practical effect on us. If we just try and split theological hairs and try and figure out all the inner workings of this, and yet it doesn't flesh out, and yet there's no power of God, it's dead. It's dead weight. God help us to be able to have a smart mind and a holy heart. The early church also, in their simplicity, immediately mobilized others to evangelize and disciple. Think about this. Think about when Jesus was on earth that healed demoniac in the Gadarenes. Jesus went to that man whom everyone else was probably scared of. I don't know how many years this guy had been enchained in his own body or enslaved in his own body, possessed by a demon. But no doubt the people from that town and city roundabout, they had seen that man. They saw that man cut himself, beat himself. They hear him howling in the night in there. And they probably say, you know what? We need to take this large circuitous route around that cemetery over there, around that graveyard, because that guy's insane. Everybody knew who that man was. And then think about it. If you were that man being enslaved in your own body for 30 or 40 years, and then a man comes to you and with authority speaks, and those demons that had tormented you for life are gone. I would be like that man. When Jesus starts walking away, I'd be saying, where are you going? Because I want to follow you. And that's exactly what the man did. I'll go with you wherever you want to go. But what did Jesus say to him? He said, no, go back into that city. Go back into that village. Go back into that town. And when you get there, tell them what I've done for you. Jesus immediately mobilized those that were saved and then told them to go share that witness and testimony with others. And I think sometimes we're too afraid to do that. We've got to wait and hold people off at arm's length for 2-3 years to see if they're going to let this religion stick. Sometimes the people that get saved have more life in them than those that have said they've been walking with God for 20 or 30 years. And if we stifle their testimony, we're stifling the work of God. But we find that not only was Jesus like that, but the early church, when people were saved, they let him loose. And we need to do the same thing. You say, well, that was the early church all the way back there. Well, let's just bounce way up now to the time of the Methodists. The Methodist movement, they preached wherever there was an opening. They preached in a schoolhouse. They preached in someone else's house. They preached on a street corner. They preached out in brush arbors. Wherever there was an opening, that's where they were preaching. They weren't waiting to have the most wonderful setup in order to get the word of God out. They just went forward on the mission with the word. They had class meetings, little small groups where people were intimately acquainted with one another, where they could question each other about their spiritual life and how they were doing. And if there needed to be reproof and correction, it happened. They prayed with one another. Then they came together for the anointed society meetings where there was anointed preaching by the circuit riders. They had small groups and big groups. And you know, it wasn't just an ecclesiastical elite at large, the people that were the circuit riders, they were the lay people. They were people that didn't go to a Bible college. They didn't have a degree, but they had fire inside their hearts. And Wesley said, here's some books that you can read. Read them on horseback. Read them wherever you are and study that way, but get the message out. And he empowered these people. It spread from a holy club in Oxford in England, from a small little group of guys that got together, read spiritual books, read over the scriptures, grilled one another, prayed together, went out and lived out their faith. It started from this small little group, and it has told us that the total membership of Methodist societies in Britain was recorded at 56,000 in 1791. And then, at a consensus in 1836, there was 1,463,000 at that national census, of 1851. Going from 56,000 in 1791 to 1.5 million in about 60 years. I don't know if all of those people were saved in that 1851 consensus, but it does speak volumes to their reach. The simplicity and power of that method, of the manner in which they lived out the Christian life, was astounding. And it was a lay-driven ministry. Then we think about the Salvation Army. Same thing. Started off in the slums of England. It started off with the low places of society, people that didn't have a chance anywhere. And it was a movement that grew out of a movement. They had the military wartime mindset and effort. After all, they're called the Salvation Army. They went out on military campaigns. They were lay-driven and maintained. William Booth would be preaching on a street corner. A drunkard would get saved. Then he would have that man go behind him, and they would walk to the next street corner where there was a brothel, a house of prostitution. And he would stand up there and he would say, now you, tell these people what just happened for you. The man's not even been saved for probably about 5 minutes. And he has that man stand up on a stool and to give his testimony. And it is told that those people, the prostitutes that are inside of the buildings, are flooding out from the brothels onto the street, begging God for mercy. Drunkards are getting saved. Was it because of the mighty preacher, William Booth? No, it was because this man who just got saved 5 minutes ago had such a touch of God on his soul and such a glow in his face that all the people that knew that wretched man, that knew that drunkard, knew that something had happened to him and it was something otherworldly, and they were under such deep conviction, they fell in their face and begged God for mercy out in the street. It doesn't have to be that hard. It doesn't have to be that we have to wait for the perfect preacher. It has to be that there is a soul that is given over to God that will then just take God at his word and testify and speak what they have both seen and heard. They were a lay-driven and a maintained movement. They mobilized people to spread the gospel and extend the borders of Christ's kingdom. And that is what vital Christianity, I'm convinced, looks like. You can find it in the early church. You can find it in many more examples than what I've said. But simplicity and of focus, simplicity of speech, simplicity of power, so that the power of the gospel may be in the forefront and not us worshiping a bunch of men. May God help us. How about it? Will you be part of God's resistance? Join the resistance.